What kind of weapon is that?
It's a
rifle.
Manufactured by Cuba.
How many rounds does it shoot?
30.
20 rounds.
Are you under here or are you in Jonestown?
No, right here.
This is where
you huh?
You have not flown into Jonestown?
No, no.
Have been in there?
No, never yet.
Yeah. Were you here when all this occurred?
Some drink poison. Forced drink poison.
Did you
get away in the jungle?
Did you hear
it? Well, you can't hear the shot from here.
Yeah, 20 miles.
You said 36 miles, 34 miles?
Get to the auditorium and then
go with them, make a run.
Yeah. You can put one here.
Yeah, go with them.
These were the people who used to live. The different huts where they used to live. You notice they have different names on them. Right?
What happened here?
Well, from around here, they started finding the bodies and so, you know, all around. See, yeah. All here.
Behind you, under the shed.
That was the pavilion where they normally used to meet and, you know, last strike, and they hold the meetings and these sort of things.
What did it look like just a few days ago when you saw it?
Well, lots of confusion, you know. Everything was just being tumbled up. You know, after all, other people were killed around the place.
You saw the bodies?
This is the pavilion, and this is where all the bodies actually were. After they used this stuff, this is where they just put their bodies down, and that was it. That was the string band across there. They had a string band on the location. That was the string band. Of course, that's the remains of the string band. You see, still have a slight scent around the place. It's still a bit smelly, you know. Where else you might find it? This here, right?
Yeah.
If you notice, that piece of instrument is a arrow, right? A bow, which they used to shoot arrows. Mm-hmm. I think with a point, right? Yeah. A poisonous sort of point, right? That's the gun which they use, right?
I see.
When they shoot it, they use that gun there. They put the arrow into the gun, or the bow as it is normally called, and then they shoot it off, right? And then it gets into the body, and they steal the end of the body. Has poison, it normally poisons the body. Hmm. And then the thing is in a triangular shape, the point. Hmm. So to get it out, you gotta pull it, and to pull it out, it will rip away all the body coming through, all the flesh. Here there's an arrow stuck in there.
Yeah. Right. Which means it was shot, but
right.
Stuck in.
Yeah. Here are all the buildings. So as to prevent people from coming in and stealing out anything that's in the buildings. All the machinery shops and all these places are closed, right? It's closed at the moment.
What's going on?
Just nailed them.
Get back on, just a second.
There were 910 evacuated from this location.
And so it is complete, then?
As far as I'm concerned, it's complete.
What happens now?
I think that's up to the embassy and the local government as to what happens.
I mean, will this place be... Do you have any orders to bulldoze this, or...?
No, this will be up to the embassy first.
Do you have any orders to burn anything?
No.
Do you know if the Guyanese army isn't going to tend to?
The only plans that are immediate right now that I know of is a sanitation area to close down the latrines and to keep the flies down, keep the mosquitoes down in the standing water. And what the future plans are, I have no idea.
Sir, let me ask you another question. Why are most of these cottages ransacked or appear to be? Is there any explanation?
Well, the explanation is that local personnel moved in here right after the mass suicide. And They went through a lot of the personal belongings.
You mean local troops, Guyanese troops?
No, the troops did none of that. I think just local inhabitants of the jungle.
You mean the Indians?
Well, let's just call them local inhabitants.
Or are the Indians? I don't know. That's why I was asking.
I haven't seen any, so I don't know.
Right. So they did ransack.
They went through it. Whether they took away anything, I don't know.
Are they the people, perhaps, that went through the bodies? Is that why...
I don't know that they went through the bodies. I don't think that any normal human being would go through something like that.
Why, sir, may I ask you that at first it was only reported 410. Suddenly it's 910. There were blankets under some of these layers.
From what I observed, the people, when they committed suicide, stood in nice, neat little circles, children in front of them. And as they died, they folded into the interior of the circle, and there were mounds of people. And as we pulled off the surface cover, we found more and more people under the mounds. Apparently, it appeared as though there were children in front of the parents as they went over. Then, of course, the parents went on top of them. It was very hard to determine from just a cursory count. I think the original count was something like 400 plus. That would have been good if there had been nobody laying underneath the exterior mound.
Sir, what about the blankets, though? How were they in between the layers?
I don't know anything about blankets.
Anything else you might add, sir?
No.
You said this wasn't pleasant. Would you elaborate on that?
Well, 910 people committed suicide in a very tropical area, and it took us 6 days to clean it up. And that's how unpleasant it got.
Yes. Thank you very much, sir.
How many troops are still here after the last body went out?
Total troops here.
Should I say enough?
And it's,
what do you
J-O-H-N-S-O-N?
What do you intend to do with this camp now?
I don't know. I think it's a high-level decision. Yes. We're military, and as soon as this operation is finished, we're out. And yeah. I don't know what it
plans. You have some orders for sanitation, though?
Yes, the medical team is coming in.
You having any problem at night with people wanting to come in still now?
Not by night. It's during the day. I think people still have a slight taboo in this place, really. Yeah.
Have what, sir?
This place is still taboo to some people, you know.
What do you mean, still taboo?
Well, a lot of the residents around here were actually afraid to come in, you know, when the place was in operation. After hearing all these tales about, you know.
When it was in operation?
Yeah.
After hearing tales of what?
No, the funny stories that came out of here, I don't know much about them. I never really knew about Jonestown until I got in. You know, just out of here.
Thank you, sir.
There are just mosquitoes and red ants and black ants. Of course, there are cats out there, too, we know, and scorpions. And our hands were badly cut. Our whole bodies were cut by the brambles and everything. It was quite miserable. There was no food, and there was rained a lot, so there was water. It rained at 4:30. It was freezing when it was raining. It was not freezing. It was very cold. It was uncomfortable. And Charles has a cold allergy, and if he becomes sick enough and from a cold, he can go into shock. So that was a consideration. And I said that I thought that if he could make it through one more night, we should stay there, no doubt. There would be trucks moving in and helicopters moving in. We did hear a helicopter, but we didn't see any vehicles. And he said he'd rather take a chance and check out the guardhouse, which is where he thought the people would be. And he very bravely, I must say, very bravely, he went ahead and he checked out the guardhouse, and there was no one. He'd taken a pole, which was used to support a banana tree, and he used to do javelin in college, and he held it like it was a javelin stick, and he was going to throw it at anybody who was there. It was a very, very brave act, and there was nobody there. Three or four little piglets running around. So we just ran the rest of the way out of Jonestown. We knew the road to Port Kaituma. We took that. We found four or five people on the highway there walking toward us. We said, is this the way to Port Kaituma? They all said yes. And then finally, it was one of those National Service trucks with young men on it when we were about a mile and a half from Port Kaituma. And I signaled for a ride, and they stopped and drove us into town. I asked them to take us to the police station, and they did, and I made this whole report to the police in Port Kaituma, and I just finished making this report to Inspector Chester of the police department here.
Mr. Lane, it's estimated that there were as many as 1,000 people at Jonestown. The figures we have are 300 to 400 dead bodies. Do you have any idea what may have happened to the other people?
I know there were many more than 300 or 400 people when I left, when I was in Jonestown. And I know a person who I consider to be very reliable, who was with the group in Jonestown, who no longer is, was very, very, very recently. And this person told me there were 1,200 people there not too long ago. And at meetings, which I was there months ago at a meeting, and it did not appear to me that there were 1,200 people, but it's an open-air place in the morning. I also know that people alone in the bush are in terrible, terrible shape, especially kids.
How could one man persuade upwards of 400 people to take their own lives?
If one man could persuade 400 people to take their own lives, there would have been no need for the semi-automatic weapons which they handed out. So while I was not present when the event took place, I think it may well.
Can you see what is
I don't know what took place there, but judging from the fact that many automatic weapons, semi-automatic weapons, and a lot of ammunition was brought up that hill just before the moment when the so-called suicide took place, it may be that there was no more of a suicide than what took place at My Lai. And judging from the rifle shots which were fired when the suicide was supposed to be taking place, that raises, of course, some additional questions about whether it was suicide.
Do you think Jones committed suicide?
I understand from the police that he was not found there. His body was not found there. So I don't know what he did.
Mr. Lane, can you say what was the motive behind this mass suicide?
I'm just a lawyer. My discipline is not in the area of abnormal psychology. I don't know. There can never be a motive behind this mass suicide or anything like this, especially if it's imposed on other people. I cannot understand a motive. I just don't know how to approach that question in rational terms, because I don't think anybody approached it in rational terms. For it to be said that it's a concentration camp surrounded by barbed wire and people every few feet with machine guns, which is some of the charges that I've heard, is false. It's also not necessary, because when you're way out there in the bush, you don't need all of that kind of thing. And articles which have container attacks never dealt with the positive aspects. And there were many positive things taking place there. I'm not suggesting for a moment that the experience was a totally, in total,
Jim, what we would like, if possible, if you could tell us, first of all, how you got involved in the People's Temple, to give us all a little backgrounder, and then describe the scenario of the arrival of the Ryan Party through the events of this weekend, all right?
Yeah, my mother became a member in late 1950s in Indianapolis. My mother became a member in the late 1950s. And she decided to move to California in 1967, and I was 17, so I came out with her in 67. And 1973, I quit because I thought the place was just crazy, and I was seeing things that I didn't agree with. What? Ever since I got out of there, I've been trying to expose what I thought would happen in People's Temple. I have a lawsuit out on Jim Jones, and in it was included the mass suicide, and it included Deborah Layton's statement of the practice of that suicide in Jonestown. And I was one of the people that was involved in a New West article over a year ago. And I've been, I've done a lot of little news reportings and talked to reporters about it. And I got involved with the trip with Congressman Ryan. I was a member of the concerned relatives, because I have three sisters, two brothers, and my mother that's there. And I hadn't seen my brothers and sisters in 4 years. And the youngest brother is 13. And talking about mass suicide, it wasn't mass suicide, it was mass murder. And that's one of the things that I had been trying to say for several years, that it was mass murder, that they'd give children poison. Children that didn't have a mature judgment to make that decision on themselves.
How did you know that happened?
How did I know that happened?
Yeah.
Well, after that, they shot at us, and I was one of the people that was lucky to get past it, because I felt the bullet go past my head. I knew they were going to go through with it. There's no way that Jones, he knew that he was done for then. So I knew he would execute it. And I feel the man that's, Hitler at least said he hated Jews, but Jones tried to hide everything he was doing, and the fact that he was a humanitarian, that he was out to help black people, and the United States was fascist, and they were trying to get them out of Guyana and get him because we were fascist. And I knew that if I went down there, I'd probably be killed. And everybody else had sort of that same feeling. And I heard from Bob's Brown's best friend, one of his friends, that he said this may be the the last time he saw that guy.
How lucky do you feel right now coming out of here alive?
I was very lucky. I mean, I, like I said, when I was at the tail of the plane on the opposite side of the trailer and tractor, I didn't hear it pull up because the engine, the one engine was on the plane. And I was, in the meantime, I was trying to hurry and get people on it because I saw the tractor come at the edge of the runway. And when the firing started, I had my back turned, and I turned around and saw the congressman, Don Harris, Bob Brown. I saw them fall immediately, and I thought maybe, well, they weren't hit. They were reacting to the sound. And Greg Robinson went down. I don't think he was hit at that time, but as I was going to run into the jungle, I told him to get up and run. So I ran to the jungle, which was about 50 yards away, and from there I dove into the swamp, and I think they thought that they had killed me because nobody followed me. I looked back and I saw anyway, the guns, you know, the guns being aimed at people's heads at close range, and I knew it was real at that time. And so I just turned around and ran into the jungle for about 2 hours. And it's too dark, I couldn't see, and I climbed up a tree and I spent the night there, at which time there was tigers and cheetahs, etc. in the woods, so I was lucky to get away from there. And one of the police officials told me that a man had his arm bit off by a cheetah there just a few weeks prior to that, and what saved him and his two dogs chased it away.
Jim, but do you know if any other people got out of the compound?
Yeah, there are some people that are out that were down in the police office in Georgetown that did get away. Right now I don't have an accurate figure, but I'd say at least 20. Okay.
What is the status of our
relatives? 20 other people.
Yeah, that got out that they were describing the conditions that were there. Their diet was mainly rice. And some greens.
Were there other people who got out of the compound?
After the shooting, a couple of planes had spotted them going off in huge groups to southwest toward the Venezuelan border through the jungle. And I think a lot of people will lose their lives like that.
What do you think the motive? What do you think the motive for the suicides is?
Was it a suicide?
I call it mass murder myself. I think that Jones just went crazy. I hate to let him get off like that, but how else could you describe an insane thing like that?
What was life in Jonestown? What was life like in Jonestown? Can you describe that? Were you in there at all? Or?
Yeah.
What was it like?
I described everybody who went down, and so did some of the other some of the relatives and some of the people there and some of the ex-members, that they would get a scenario. They would get a performance of music, and everybody would say they were happy, and it was rehearsed, and that's exactly what happened. But we were lucky to get in the next day, and some of the people did decide to leave. And I was impressed with the fact that they cleared so much land, because it indicated a lot of work. But I wasn't impressed with what I had seen. My mother and my couple sisters obviously showed that they were malnourished. Their cheeks were sunken in. They were thin through the clavicles, and they're bent over. And they weren't healthy.
Where do your relatives know?
They didn't want to come home. They said they were happy, et cetera, but some of the people who did want to come home finally got on the truck. It was just before the congressman was attempted, before he was a fellow attempted to stab him, which Charles Gary and Mark Lane helped to subdue the man.
Did you think the State Department should have given you more assistance, the State Department?
Well, I think his name is Don Dyer, Dick Dyer, Dwyer. He's assistant to the ambassador over there. I think he was tremendous. I didn't think that we got all the assistance that we could have gotten. It was very hard to get anything out of the embassy there, except for, like I said, Dick Dwyer. And the congressman was, I can't describe it. He was he's just a great person.
Can you identify any of the people who were doing the shooting?
Yes, I can, but I just want to hold off on that right now because I know some of the relatives of people, the people who did the shooting, their help, they wouldn't, I think they should be told first.
Were they related to you at all, any of your relatives?
No, none of the shooters.
What are your feelings about this, the whole situation?
Well, I think that Jones did it because he didn't want to be exposed for the inhumane, bizarre, evil things that he was doing. So he's going to take everybody down with him just so that he wouldn't be exposed.
Jim, do you think Jones is actually dead?
I don't know.
Are your relatives alive?
Or who?
All of your relatives are alive.
Oh, I don't know if any of my relatives are alive.
Do you have any thoughts on...
Yeah, they wouldn't come out. If I had attempted to try to drag off any of our relatives, we would have all been killed there.
So your brother and your brothers and your sisters may have been among those who were massacred.
Do you have any thoughts about Jones possibly being dead? I mean, any...
He could be alive and he could be dead. It's just, I don't know. Until I see him. Well, I just wish it all wouldn't have happened. I don't have any feelings toward him right now. No, I can't.
Are there any eyewitnesses to the events at Jonestown the last day that you know of?
There were some people that I talked with that escaped through the jungle that did get, they did see some of the children, etc., being given poison. Yeah.
Well, do you think he was always crazy? You said he's crazy. No. Do you think he was always crazy?
No, I don't. I don't think he was always like that. In the last several months, the people down there said he's sort of bizarre. And in the eyes of the people that were doing the shooting, and it was like they weren't human. They weren't in this world. I tried to talk with one of the guys as he was trying to buy some time to get people on the plane. He wouldn't talk with me. He had a deep-seated stare, and it was of death. He wouldn't talk to me. He just turned around and
How about Larry Lake?
Is that who you saw that go out late?
Yeah, I saw him. He had the same look in his eye too. I was on a dump truck with Larry. I knew he didn't have a pistol on him then because I alerted Tim Reiterman and Bob Flick that this man wasn't a part of the people leaving, and I was bumping around. I touched and see that he didn't have it, and I heard after all this was over that they saw another party give Layton a pistol after everybody had been searched before he got onto the first small aircraft.
Who gave the poison to the children?
There was just stories. One story was that Jones himself was giving some of the poison to the children. That's why I call it mass murder. There's no way that you can get children to make a judgment like that.
How do you think Jones died?
Well, if he died, I think he'd had to do it himself, because I don't think he would let anybody do that.
What about his followers in San Francisco? Do you think that they will carry out Jones's plan and...
I've always been a target. I've had a lot of death threats. I've had a lot of death threats on my son, even before, back in 1973, 74, and right now I don't think that'll be any different. Maybe somebody try it out.
Is there a death list, and should politicians be worried right now?
I don't know about a death list, but I'd say that anybody who probably try to expose Jones should be concerned just by the event of what's happened.
Why do you think those people obeyed Jones? Why do you think they followed him?
Well, see, it's easy to understand imprisonment when you're behind a bar, when you're behind bars in a prison. But it's I think the general population don't really understand mind control, and that's exactly, he did a very thorough job of it. And that's why people did what he said. They're mind controlled.
Can we bring the other people forward?
Can I just ask you one question? You mentioned Hitler. Do you believe that Jones hated blacks?
Oh, yes. Yes, definitely. I think he hated blacks. And I think that Hitler hated Jews. He said that Jones went under a humanitarian cause and did what he did. And it was the most evil thing I've ever witnessed or read about in history.
Thank you very much, Jim. Thank you very much, Jim.
Could you tell us your experience, please? Your name, please.
My name is Grace Stone. I don't know what you want to know.
Grace, how about your son?
That's one thing right now.
I haven't gotten any word about my son yet. Last thing I did is I pleaded with Charles Gary to help me with my son.
What do you think happened?
To my son? I really don't know.
Any reason to be optimistic?
6 years old. You never know. I mean, I don't know.
What do you think the secret of Jones's sway over people was? What sort of hold do you think he had on people, and why do you think he had it?
Jones was a brilliant man. Everybody I talked to, I always told him never to underestimate Jim Jones. Like I said, he was brilliant. He never did anything drastic until the end. He did everything slowly. That's how he got people to change so drastically. It wasn't done in one day or one year. I was there 6 years. By the sixth year, it was pretty bad.
When was the last time you saw your son, and under what circumstances?
I saw John in September of 1976. I had to wait 5 weeks after I put in a request from Jim Jones. And I had to meet in L.A. because he was too threatened for me to meet in San Francisco.
What are your own feelings about John?
I went down there, and I was met by temple members at a restaurant and taken in, and I was treated very hostily by one and very decent by another. I got into the grounds at the L.A. church, and there's many security and guards around me, and I finally got to see John, and Jones kept trying to get me to come back, and I sat in a meeting and he never told the people I left till 8 months after, because he knew a lot of people would leave if they knew I left.
Grace, do you regard your son as having been there at the suicide?
No, it's not a surprise. I had an idea because I'd gone through a false mass suicide. I went through one talk, and I went through one where we actually took a drink, and we were told we had an hour to live, so that Jones could find out how people would react psychologically.
Why did you do it? Why did you take it?
We had no choice. We were in a planning commission meeting of 120 peers. People waved guns around and said that they would kill us. So we just did it, and Jones wanted to psych us out to see if we were going to be as little Jim Jones. He was priming us to be little Jim Jones, and he wanted to see how strong we were and who was going to break and who wasn't.
But the shooting of a congressman at the airport, none of that's a surprise?
Well, you know, I think in my subconscious I might have thought about it. I warned people, I told them, and when I talked to Debbie, who defected 6 months ago, and I read her affidavit, I mean, when I talked to Debbie the first night, I'd been in that church 6 years and I knew a lot. And when Debbie told me what she said, I was so repulsed and sick that my stomach, I was sick and I had to excuse myself from the table.
Do you regard your son as being held hostage?
It's brainwashing. We weren't allowed much sleep. We had unnourished food. We were kept up night after night. We'd go to planning commission meetings where we'd have 8 hours of work, and then we'd go maybe anywhere from 8 to 12 to 16 hours of planning commission meetings. I mean, we were just...
That was down in...
That was in San Francisco in Ukiah.
What is your job in?
I was a head counselor over three cities, San Francisco, Redwood Valley, and Los Angeles. I basically tried to help people with their needs they had problems getting money for proper medical care, and just their basic needs, and I really tried to help those people, and I obviously had some persuasion because I was able to help them. I don't know where Tim Stone is. Tim, I was, if there was any good word about John or whatever, he was going to try to go back and be of some use.
Grace,
I need you to go. If Reverend Jones is dead at this point, do you think his church is going to fall apart, or is there...
Definitely his church. He always knew his church would fall apart if he left. He had no doubt in his mind about that.
So this is the end of the People's Temple as far as you're concerned?
Better be.
Well, what are the people...
Why are people so concerned about getting shot? Do you think people will follow his orders anyway?
I don't know. I'm sure these people have gone, they're so sick and their minds are so demented that, they just might want to do it. And, they're going to do it knowing that they'll get shot. I mean, would you want to live after, you know, what you've been through? I mean, but I heard Debbie Blakey say, I said, you know, I was amazed. I'd known these people for 6 years, and I said, hey, Debbie, I don't know these people anymore.
You feel right.
Yeah.
Grace, what are your feelings about everything that's happened to you, the whole experience?
Well, I think it's a tragedy. I wish that I'd had... I asked people, I said, hey, tell me what I have to do. Who do I have to talk to? And I always got, well, I don't know. I always got these answers. And I just wish that I had had the, you know, the knowledge of, if there was any knowledge to be gotten, to know what to do.
What do you believe, Joe?
Great. It's time to go.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm going to try to ask you questions that will evoke from you your impressions,
okay.
And with our intent of laying in pictures. Charles, what were you thinking as you approached Jonestown?
I was thinking to some extent about what I had been through, and I was also thinking what it would be like to see 300 or 400 bodies. I had an idea, but I didn't really know. And as we came in by helicopter, it looked as if someone had dumped a bunch of colored paper on the ground, because these people were all lying there in with red and yellow and white shirts and sweaters on. And from the air, it almost looked as if it was simply the end of a carnival sort of thing. When we got on the ground, and as you got closer, the stench was horrible. The bodies, as you walked up, were bunched together, many of them with their arms still around each other. The faces were contorted. Blood was coming out of many of the noses. Foam was kind of around the mouths. And it was just a horrible sight of people dead, many of whom I had seen only 2 days before, some of whom I had talked to, and the vat of poison was still there, just as it had been when they all drank it. It was a mixture, it was a purplish color of Kool-Aid and cyanide. It was an awful, eerie kind of feeling to see all of this.
You had seen Jim Jones in life, and now you were looking at him in death.
Yes, I did walk over to see his body, and I left there thinking he was a demented, sick man. And some of the people a couple of people I asked specifically where their bodies were, because I thought they had been nice, and I was sad that they were dead. Frankly, to see this man who had been responsible for sending people to try and kill me and actually killing other people, I must admit, in a way, I was just sort of glad to see that he wouldn't cause any more trouble.
There are many impressions, there are many theories about why this happened. You were one of the few persons there. You are the only survivor of that whole horror up there, the only survivor presently here in Jonestown. What do you think caused this?
I think that he was afraid that if these people who had wanted to leave with us made it out of the country, they would begin to expose, as really had not been exposed before, the real horror of what was going on there. And I also think, in a kind of personal way, he saw this as the beginning of the end of his kind of demented empire. And rather than allow a kind of slow death by allegations and statements and that sort of thing, he decided that his life and the lives of these people had come to an end, and he wanted to make sure that they died rather than continue to live under the kind of scrutiny that was beginning to be focused on them.
Thank you.
Okay,
did you see a young boy at an altar
Yes. One of the things I'll never forget was there was a boy who died.
Let me start again. Tell me about that scene.
One of the things I'll never forget among this sort of carnage of people was a boy who was sort of on the steps of this platform, which kind of served as an altar, and he died almost in a position of kind of bowing to Jones, who was about 5 feet away on the altar, whose body was 5 feet away, and I assume was 5 feet away. And he literally appeared to be worshiping Jones at the time he died.
What about caches of arms?
When we got there, the police had found something on the order of 30 to 40 automatic rifles, hand revolvers. They said that they had found hundreds of thousands of rounds of ammunition in this place. And I looked at those guns, and I remembered only 2 days before that Don Harris had asked him in an interview about a report we had heard of a gun that had been brought in there. And I remember him saying, it's a bold-faced lie, it's another lie, it's people are trying to destroy us. We don't have guns in this place. Why would we need guns? Anybody is free to leave who wants to leave. And then I saw this incredible display of weapons that had been all over the place. And it was just one of the things that I remembered, one of the lies or one of the things that we had been told, and the truth now was sort of there in front of me anyway. You go back and come back?
Mm-hmm. Every day. Okay, I'll ask him something to talk, but we're not recording. What was your impression of? Is it Stavon or Steve Jones?
Steve Jones. My impression is that he's very, very attractive, very articulate, but so were the other people I talked to up there. And I don't trust these people, because we've heard that really this basketball team is in fact the marksmen. They are the ones who are trained to kill. And we also had been told by the people who left that there was a plan that if this should happen, that these people would be sent back to the United States to take care of other people who they considered to be their enemies. And I don't know if you were there when I asked about this, the question about the basketball team, but he sort of gulped.
Was the guy, the coach on the end?
Yeah.
The short guy?
No, the black guy.
With a green shirt? Or was he standing up?
No, the one who was sitting next to him,
mm-hmm.
The coach.
He's a coach.
Yeah, supposedly.
Yeah. You got enough, Jack?
Listen to me. You keep talking. Listen to me one second.
I'm not worried for myself, but I really think...
Change in our laws where you can really get into cults. And I do hope that the assassins listen somewhere along the line. The ones that are out to get the defectors, that they will be stopped.
Do you think your husband is so far gone that you need your husband to kill you? There's no confirmation that your husband is alive or that's what you told us what you did about his
that's
pursuits.
That's
right. Mrs. Snod, do you think your husband is so far gone that you would even try to kill you?
Oh, yes. Without hesitation. I am a defector. I'm a traitor to him.
Do you think you'll ever see him again?
Why wasn't he? Put this in a better way. Now there is talk that there is an assassination squad. Have they acted before? If they didn't act before, why would they do it now when so many of you sitting here are all defectors, admitted defectors, and have been for some time?
They haven't had a chance to yet. They're not going to be obvious. They're not going to come out tonight with all of you here when they know that we're being taken care of and assassinate us.
That leads me to another
just a
question.
I want to go back to
okay.
The point.
All right.
The point is that there are defectors here in this room. You had contacted Representative Ryan a while ago. At least one of you had sent a petition to the U.S. State Department, answered or unanswered. You are known defectors to the church. You have only recently, because of these incidents, obtained an incredible amount of publicity. As known defectors, then, why, say, 3 months ago, do you feel that the assassination team did not act, the squad did not act, or have they?
Can I say something about that? 2 weeks ago,
I think, does she need mics? So
yeah, she can move over and be a little helpful.
I'm all lost on time, okay?
Your name is
Grace Stone. Spell it. S-T-O-N. I think it's 2 weeks ago, Timothy Carter, who was found in Jonestown and is in being arraigned in Georgetown court today, came to Mike Cartmell at his job, did the same, approached Mike Cartmell the exact same way that Deborah Layton, who defected 6 months ago, came, said the exact same stuff. Debbie came smoking, Tim Carter came smoking, which was, you didn't do that in the church, okay? He was very nervous, just like Debbie. Why did you contact Mike? Oh, we asked him, why did he contact Mike of all people? Well, it was a known fact that he worked at that particular job. The very next day after Mike met with this Tim Carter, Mike and Debbie called me about 8 o'clock at night and said that they had just caught someone following them, that it just dawned on them. And so Tim Carter was at this house. He made requests specifically to see myself, Debbie Blakey, Tim Stone, Jim Cobb. He wanted Jim Cobb some excuse to look at his teeth. And when Jim Cobb got in Jonestown, he was in the compound there. So I think it was a setup. I think he was going to take care of us on this end. But something happened because he was supposed to meet with Tim on a Saturday, a week before the killing, and he didn't show up. And we checked his room, and he had checked out.
Let me understand. You believe now, and may have believed even a week ago, that they were going to kill you then.
Oh, I thought I was going to be killed all the time. I was on Market Street walking down the street one day, and some guy screamed out my name, which happened to end up being Mike Cartmell. And I said, well, this is it, you know. But I didn't know it was Mike at the time.
What do you make of all this? I see that you're quite uncomfortable, obviously, and shaking before the press and tired, but what do you make of all this now?
What, you mean the assassination attempt?
The assassination squad. Is there indeed, as I was told last night, a pervasive fear, and it still exists, and how real is it to the people sitting in the room?
Well, I don't know how real it is to us because we're really so exhausted and tired. You know what, do you understand what I'm saying? I believe it. I think I'm not giving enough. You know, I can't live 20. I've got enough problems. I can't live 24 hours a day, you know, just contemplating on, am I going to be killed? If it happens, it happens. I think it's going to happen, or I think somebody's going to try it. I think another thing is that, you know, Jones always wanted to go down in history. I think that's why he picked this. He felt that this was one of his best opportunities because he had Congressman Ryan there and the news media, which are really, I don't know of any other news where news people and a congressman or any kind of high government person like that has been killed. And I think that was his opportunity. And I don't think that Jim Jones, that's going to be his last stand. I think he's got other people, so this will again surge up.
May I pursue that? And we haven't gotten into this yet, at least I don't know that we have. Jim Jones is the one person who is uppermost in everyone's mind in the media, in the newspapers, in people here. But is there anyone else in the church who helped him, who might, assuming that he is dead, as some believe him to be, is there anyone else who might take over from where he left off? And have we seen the end of the People's Temple?
Well, I hope we've seen the end of People's Temple. I think we better have seen the end. There are several people that I know of that I'm really concerned about.
But if he's dead, do you think the assassination squad will still move on without the leader?
Well, yes. That's a point that needs to be looked at because some of these people, you know, that were briefed by Jones, that were even sent down to Guyana for 2 weeks, you know, and told who to get first and what to do with them.
Just a moment. People were sent down there and were briefed on who to kill.
Debbie, who left 6 months ago, told me of a specific person, a woman, who was briefed for 2 weeks on what was to be done to us and who it was to be done to. And I believe Debbie, and I think if people had believed Debbie 6 months ago, she sent a 10-page affidavit to the State Department. She met with the State Department a week ago yesterday.
Do you know of any People's Temple member now in the United States, right now, who's been the victim of these alleged assassination squads? Is there anyone dead that you can point to that would support the notion that these assassination squads are in fact at work?
Bob Houston.
Who's Bob Houston?
Bob Houston is Sam Houston's son. Sam Houston's a freshman. And Bob was smashed between two trains. And I feel very strongly that that was not an accident due to the fact that Bob Houston had a job at Juvenile Hall. I took him to work several mornings at 4 o'clock in the morning. We lived in the same community. Bob didn't even get out of the car without putting his gloves on for fear his hands would get dirty and they would find out at Juvenile Hall that he had a second job and he would have been fired if they had found that out.
Also, Bob Houston talked to his wife who had left several months earlier just that morning, and he was going to send her suitcase and her personal belongings to her, and the church reprimanded it for him that morning before he was killed.
But he was
the reason
not
I mentioned
the
gloves
time,
is
right?
that the gloves were found on the back of the train, not on Bob.
But you're not allowed to talk to anybody that left, and he was caught. He went and asked Sharon Amos if he could send the clothing.
You asked a question earlier about the dedication of the assassination squad. I would like to point out, as I found out last night from my husband's brother, ever since he was a child, he's been fascinated by hitmen, stories about hitmen, movies about hitmen, and I am aware of several instances where we went to movies where he would discuss it at length for ages, absolutely ages. He's fascinated by this. And I think the other man that, or whoever else, men or women that are on this squad, have the same dedication and the same fascination. And I do think they'll carry through.
Gracious.
Have you heard anything about your son-in-law?
No, I haven't. I've just been told not to believe any reports because it's not been confirmed.
Larry Latham has just been formally charged with murder in Georgetown. What's your reaction to that?
Larry Latham, when we used to be in planning commission meetings, Larry used to get up and, one time Jim says, well, should we all die, you know? And so some of us said, or what should we do? And I said, well, you know, I think we should hold off. And Larry turned and screamed at me and he said, so I'm really ticked off at you, Grace, because I have a lot of respect for your opinion and I don't like your answer. And also Larry Layton used to get up and just kill him, kill him, kill him. That's what he used to do. He used to get up with his fist. I mean, because Larry wasn't a very patient person and, you know, he used to just sit there and, you know, he'd just get up and do that and everybody just sit there and look for him, amazed. I mean, he was the only one that would do that.
Do you know who the members of the assassination squad are specifically? Do you know names?
We have, sure.
Have those names appeared on the dead list? They're all still alive as far
no,
as...
they me? Haven't. The FBI has those names.
How many are there, roughly?
12?
I think
about 12.
Say
12.
That we
maybe
came up
25?
With a list of about 25, approximately.
Were they all in Guyana or in
no,
San Francisco?
There's
both.
The,
half
there's,
and half?
There's one woman that I saw in Washington, D.C. last Monday with Mark Lane, and she was not seen in Jonestown, and she's not been heard of at all. She was, I believe, the mastermind of the whole organization.
What's her name? Who's
that? Terry J. Buford. Tim Stone used to say that she was a brilliant woman, and when she thought of many of the... she had a lot of experience from her family life, I understand, and she, Tim used to tell me all the stuff she used to think up, and she was, the ideas, and...
Why do you think she was a mastermind?
Buford, B-U-F-O-R-D, it's a known fact that she was.
I guess that's what we're saying. What do you know about her?
Okay, she was living in a closet in the temple up on the top floor. This closet was a long... like rectangular closet, and in that closet in San Francisco Temple, 1859 Gary, and it not only was a closet, you know, the closet was maybe say this wide, but she had files in there, tables and things like that, and I forgot my question.
Every phone call came through, she came.
No, oh.
Why do you think she must have been?
Because of her intelligence and because of her background.
Do you feel that she will take over and form another cult, or are you saying?
I think she'll act alone. Because and also she was the one that Jim would contact for the guns, and she made the statement to Debbie Blakey, "I can't send any more guns. Jim's going to kill all those people." Another thing is about Buford. She lived in this closet, and she was always up, and she was always shaking like this. Even years ago, when I went to, and after I left in July, in September of 1976, I had an opportunity to go down to L.A. to see my son. I saw Terry Buford.
she was so scrawny. She was about 5'7". She was so scrawny. I said to Jim Jones, I said, you know, Jim, I said, that girl's going to die on you. And his response was, well, many good revolutionaries died for what they believed in. Another time, Terry Buford, they carried her out of her closet room, and her eyes were glassy, and they didn't know if she was dead or alive.
How close
was she? She was also going to UC Berkeley. She used to be a journalist.
How close was she? Successor to Jim Jones.
I'm going to interject here if Nikki doesn't control this, okay?
Thank you.
Okay, I wanted to emphasize Neva's point, and that was the plea that we give out as a group, all of us, people that aren't here, that are not represented, but who have been involved in People's Temple, for all members now who still call themselves members of People's Temple, and for all ex-members who are hiding, who are afraid, we give out, you know, it is our advice, it's our best feelings, for them to step forward and to talk about what they know about Jim Jones, what they know about their life in People's Temple, what they know about the weapons, everything they know. We know from personal experience the load that is lifted from us when we trust other people with this information. These people that we've been talking about, Terry Buford, Sandy Bradshaw, where are they? They're known hit people. No one can find them. Where's Don Sly? You know, if these people are sitting out right now in the public and they're reading the newspapers and they don't feel like they're going to kill any of us, if they feel like this is all over with, done with, they're sick of the whole thing and they're glad that they're finally free of People's Temple, then they need to make themselves known, their whereabouts known. We're not going to prosecute and we're not going to press charges. You know, we understand their plight more than probably anybody else in the country. So we just ask that they give up their death wishes, give up their assassination wishes. Jim Jones is dead. Let him die. Let the 400 people that are already dead be the last ones to die for the cause of People's Temple. It was an empty cause that was misguided, totally, totally misguided. Okay, the next lady that is going to speak is Terry Cobb. She's the program director here at the Human Freedom Center. And she is going to give you her feelings about the concerned feelings that we have for the surviving people.
How do you spell your first name?
T-E-R-E-S-A, Teresa Cobb.
T-E-R, yes, sir.
I'd like to say to people that are in the United States and also over there in Ghana that I am a living witness. I've been out for 7 years. For two, I ran for my life. Then I came to the realization that I am not going to run anymore. Yeah, it fears me that people are after to kill me, but hey, I am not afraid anymore. If they want me, they know where I'm at, okay? And even if I die, at least I can die with the peace of mind that I tried to do something to stop this. And if I don't die, then right on, I have a peace of mind to enjoy life for the first time in 26 years. I'd like to also say that I would want very much to tell the people there of my relatives, if they are still alive, and to the other relatives and friends and of ours and family, come back to mothers. I no longer blame you. I don't blame you. Hey, we were victims of an insane, sick mind. I love you. Whatever I have is yours. Come home.
Yes, we all feel that way.
Right.
We want our people back, and we want the U.S. government to do everything they can to get our people out of there.
And also, we'd like for the government to recognize the fact that we've been through this. We've got firsthand knowledge of this thing, and we'll help in whichever capacity we can for the people who are over there now, and for the Guyanese government and the American government there now. We'll help. We'll go back to Jonestown if they feel a need that we can fulfill a need. There are reports that there are hidden buildings, or there's buildings in Jonestown with hidden compartments, hidden floors underneath where people are still possibly hidden. We want to plead to the people in Jonestown to give this information out. If they know where people could be hidden, if they know where there's still people alive, to say so. All we've heard from Jonestown is Stephen Jones's feelings about his father. We want to hear some more feelings from Jonestown, because they know more about it than we do, and we think that there should be pressure put on those people. They've been through a lot, true, but they're going to go through a lot more if they don't talk.
What are your feelings about Stephen Jones?
Oh, well, I talked to Stephen.
I lived with the Jones family, and all I can say is that I don't, I trust very few people that have made comments. What was it? Who was the lady last night with Stephen?
Paula Mann.
Paula Mann. It's because I know her commitment at his home.
Charles Gary is going to hold a news conference at 2 o'clock this afternoon. What would you people like us to convey to him? What do you want to say to Charles Gary?
We want our people home. Anybody else?
I'd like to know, Mr. Gary was the one I left and I begged him, and he knows that we never had the means that Jones did to fight that case. And I want to know how he feels.
I would like to say this. Charles Gary, back in 1968, was a hero to me, a street fighter. I believed he was one of the greatest lawyers in the country. But something has happened to Charles Gary. I think money has corrupted the man as maybe the money corrupted Jim Jones. And I want Charles Gary to know that many people in this country has lost faith in him over this.
Is he still part of the movement, do you think?
I'll tell you that I never believed Charles Gary was part of the movement. I think money from Jim Jones spoke to Charles Gary.
Do you have any other names of hit people? Like, we were talking about Terry Buford, and do you know personally some other?
Yes, I do, and I gave them to the FBI, and I'd rather not talk about it anymore.
I'd like to say something about Charles Gary. He was very rude and very crude to me when I was trying to contact my son. And, very, very rude. I know he got a snow job just like everybody else did, obviously. And I know he was snowed. But as an attorney that I, like Wayne, deeply respected for years and really appreciated the causes that he worked for, I feel that he should have more of an open mind. I don't feel his mind was open. From what I understand, he has been given the title to People's Temple in San Francisco, and therefore, as far as I'm concerned, he's after the money. And I think it's time he reevaluate his position in life and what he plans on doing with it. Personally, I'd like to see an open apology from him.
Just a moment. He was given people ownership, title.
That's what I was told. The church was signed over to him.
Who told you that?
Oh, I don't remember. I really do not remember.
When was it signed over to him?
They should go in the temple. They should go in his office and confiscate the files of the temple and find out.
Mm-hmm. You know, I'd also like to say to our relatives that aren't here in this area and other areas, and also Madonna, Jonestown, or via Jonestown, that we may seem like we're under a lot of pressure. We have been. However, we are strong, very strong people. My brother made it through that jungle. He is back. He is all right. That don't panic. Don't feel that, well, they're falling to pieces, that if we come there, that they won't be able to deal with them. We made it this far, and we'll forever make it.
Were you surprised by the amount of money that was found over there? I'm changing the subject.
No, I wasn't. No, I wasn't. I was in the offering room. I saw thousands and thousands of dollars come in, Social Security checks signed over, coming money, all over, from Indianapolis, Indiana, all the way out here into the different areas that he's established himself in.
We told you about the money. Why should we be surprised? We told you about it.
Were people threatened? I mean, forced to give that money? Here in San Francisco?
People were a victim of a massive brainwashing processes. You go to a meeting 5 days a week, and meetings 10 hours, 11, 12 hours. The kids would fall asleep. They'd make them wake up and spank them if they wouldn't. Constantly just spamming the information, do this and do that. You are your environment. Sooner or later, you will believe whatever's thrown out to you if you're subject to
people gave the money voluntarily, but were some
they were coerced into it. The children were kept up night after night in those meetings. When they fell asleep in school and they were reported to their parents for falling asleep, they were publicly brought up before the group and beaten.
You were singled out if they knew you had money and you did not give it. Pressure was put up on you to give money. I went communal. My grandmother died, and I was told that if anyone inside of this that was not inside of this organization, that we'd have to say goodbye to her forever. When she died, she left me her diamond watch. The pressure, I cannot believe you, to tell you that I was given, told to give that watch, give it up, and among many other things. Yeah, I mean, you know, hey, we were free. Whatever they told us to do, you did it because you saw the beatings. You know that they could blackmail you. You could see by the snap of the finger that whatever he wanted you to do, that it would be done.
You gave up the watch?
Yes, I gave it up. It was a diamond watch. I mean, I had no choice. You got all these people breathing down your neck, and this man... And saying, give your all. If you don't, you're not loyal. You won't be protected. And on. Yeah, I gave it up.
Can we hear, were there others in this room who gave up houses?
We've talked about that greatly in the past. And we've told you today that, you know, when you go...
When I went back to identify bodies, all the babies I had seen, you know, were next to the mothers, some next to the fathers. All of them had poison, so I would imagine that the parents had taken them by force or willingly, I'm not sure.
You believe that your wife poisoned your daughter?
Well, I believe she was holding her. I don't know if she willingly or willingly did it. That's what I'm saying. I know that, I mean, it's obvious to me she had her arms around her. I mean, when I went back to find her.
Knowing Jonestown, as you did, knowing your family, why would your wife have done that?
I don't think she had a choice. I don't think anybody there had a choice on whether they lived or died. They had to do what was the will of the of Jim Jones.
Why didn't they have a choice?
Well, he, I'm speaking of Jones now, had the voice. I mean, he made the decisions on what to do, and obviously he thought that this was the end of People's Temple for some reason or another, even though obviously before all, even with the people who were leaving, Congressman Ryan still thought it was a success and thought that Jonestown was a, you know, and it actually was. I mean, it had a lot of problems.
What I'm coming to is, if Jim Jones stood up and said, let's everybody commit suicide and let's kill all the children, would your wife have poisoned your child because Jim Jones said so?
That's a hard question. I think she might have.
Why?
Because there was nothing else in life she had. Especially when we were like us, who had grown up in the temple from, you know, being a teenager. You don't have anything else in life but what you've been taught in People's Temple, what you've been given. You're dependent on it. And you believed whatever, you know, he would tell you was the truth because you'd heard nothing else. And I believe a lot of people thought the same way. There was nothing else in life if you didn't have Jim Jones and People's Temple. And if that was going to fall apart, you might as well die.
You believe that?
I would say maybe up to maybe Friday or Saturday I did. But I was, you know, it's foolish because it's ridiculous. No, I'm not now, not at all.
You were in Jonestown. You escaped the suicides because you were in a corner of the village too far away to know that everybody else was committing suicide.
Well, I didn't know that. I didn't know it had started, although we were allowed out to take a package somewhere. We didn't know that the suicides were starting until after we had left, and my brother had told me.
It's totally by chance. I mean,
and
totally by chance.
Still to this day, I don't know why we were picked.
If you had been closer to the central area when Jim Jones said, now it's time for all of us to die, would you have poisoned yourself?
I don't think so. I think they would have had to fight me.
And yet your wife did, and so far as you know, poisoned your child.
Yes. I think from the judge things, I think at first, from what I've heard, there were some people who didn't want to, and there was one woman I've heard who stood up and they all shouted her down. And so a lot of people at the first part thought, you know, well, it's going to be an easy death, which he said it would be, you know, before. It would be an easy death, no pain. We'd all meet somewhere and, you know, God knows where. And here now, I heard that I think at first a lot of people would have done it willingly, you know, no problem at all. But I think as things would go on, a lot more people would not want to. And a lot of people, you know, would hold back from doing it. You see what I'm saying? As things gone on, people saw the horror of it. People would less want to listen to Jones and think more for their own mind.
You are how old?
I'm 20.
And you had been a part of People's Temple for how long?
Just over 5 years.
And you lived here in Guyana at Jonestown and in Georgetown for how long?
14 months in Guyana, 9 of which were in Jonestown, 5 in Georgetown.
Let me ask you the question I asked Tim a minute ago. What was there a need in your life that People's Temple met?
A lot of them. I mean, I had no mother, essentially, during most of my childhood. And just my dad, who was, he's in his older years, and, you know, I was young. You know, fault of his, of course. But so I essentially needed some parenthood or a father and mother figure. I needed a lot more companionship, as I didn't have a lot of friends, especially after moving to a new city. Didn't really have a lot of friends, although I had some.
So you
and that was fulfilled when I, almost very quickly when I came down.
What was fulfilled quickly? Tell me that again.
Friendship, a lot of people who immediately were warm to me, which I had never felt before, you know. It's really, and that's one thing really attracted me, you know, is that so many people were so warm to me so quickly.
Why do you think they were so warm so quickly?
Well, I mean, at that point, I think people were, in People's Temple. Or at that point, you know, a lot closer to each other, and they were happy to see people join People's Temple. It was, you were taught at that time to be friends with everyone, to love everyone type of a thing. And people believed it, and I believed it.
All right, I want to ask, once I get this running, if we ever do. Did you believe... Don, would you pour the guys some coffee? Tim wanted some, and you've got it over there. And all right, sit with
me. Anytime.
Mike, did you believe that Jim Jones was God?
Well, I believe he had some sort of power.
The truck went by and blocked out your answer. Did you believe that Jim Jones was God?
I believe he had some sort of power. You know, it seemed to cause me to fake all the stuff he was doing, you know, in the temple up there. But God, not really.
You thought it was somehow divine?
Yeah, I believe he had some sort of, you know, I mean, just the way he had spoke, you know, and the way he presented himself, it seemed that way.
That he was somehow in touch with God?
I don't know, in touch. I mean, as far as the religious aspect, he was not religious. I mean, he spoke from, you know, some verses from the Bible and so forth, but anybody who knows anything about Jim Jones, he was not a religious person.
Well, what was he?
He was an atheist. Although he believed, you know, there was Jesus and everything, but he believed more of a equalitarian type of a living.
He was more interested in socialism, Marxism?
More so, as we got down here more, it was more into the Marxist-Leninist, especially down here in Guyana. Do we just call it equalitarianism and socialism in the States?
He told you that he didn't believe in God?
In a divine God that, you know, he said, how can there be a God with three quarters, you know?
God.
You know, a God who loved all and loved everything, yet there's starving babies throughout the world and suffering throughout the world. How could there be a loving God?
Jim Jones told you he did not believe in God.
Yeah, and a loving God. That's
not... He said he didn't believe there was a loving God.
Sorry.
He didn't believe there was a God figure, a thinking, conscious entity.
Yeah, that's correct.
Did that strike you as strange for Reverend Jim Jones to say?
Well, as you got to know People's Temple, not really. As you know, People's Temple is just not an ordinary group. And it's obvious even more so now. Yeah, I mean, you pretty quickly got to know this, you know, that... And, I mean, in a way, it made sense. The way he would portray it as, at least it made sense to me at the time, of course.
When, how did Jim Jones say this? Was he speaking from a platform, or was
he
talking to you?
No, he was speaking from a platform. He said it publicly.
Jim,
anybody who's been in any service at People's Temple has heard that.
And
it's not a deep, dark secret.
No. Hmm. Anybody at any time, practically, who's been... in any meeting of People's Temple would know that.
Well, then why did you... If Jim Jones himself said that he didn't believe in God, as most people understand God, a thinking entity, what was it that made you think that he had divine contact, since he himself disputed any sort of divine entity?
I mean, contact with God?
Yeah.
Well, he never claimed he had... I don't know, maybe he did claim, I don't know, but... He, he seemed to know a lot about what, you know, he would say things would happen, a lot of times they would happen. I don't know if that was all right or what. There's just some things that, about him that obviously I'm sorry, it's very hard to... It's been a long time.
All right. Let me ask you, Tim. Your wife... Over on Tim. Did your wife murder your child?
I don't know. I know the first thought that came into my mind was when I saw my baby dead in her arms was... they'd murdered my son. Not that she had murdered my son. I think what I thought was Jim Jones had murdered my son.
A mother's first instinct, ordinarily,
is to protect the child.
And yet, from what evidence we have, there's reason to believe that your wife poisoned your child.
True.
Why would she have done that?
I don't think she had any choice. It's a good question. I mean, it's a question I'll probably ask myself for the rest of my life. Along with, why didn't I get my wife and my son out of there sooner? And that's guilt I have to live with for the rest of my life. I don't know. I just don't know.
Would your wife have poisoned your child because Jim Jones said so?
I can't believe that, because I know how she felt about her son. I can't believe that. I know that when I saw her kneeling on the ground, there was tears going down her cheeks, and she was obviously in pain and grieving. I leaned over and I started crying, and I said, I love you so much. I love you. I love you. And she started going into convulsions. And I wasn't... all I was thinking about at that point was... I mean, I had nothing else to live for. I mean, my son was dead and my wife was dying. And I had a way out of Jonestown, and I took it. I mean, why I was picked, I don't know.
Can you explain picked?
Well, like I said, Maria, I was walking down the path by the pavilion, and Maria Katsura saw me, and it was like she just said, come here, I want to talk to you. It wasn't like she was looking for me. I think it was just absolutely, totally, just, I don't know if you call it luck or...
This is before the suicide ritual began. And so she said what to you?
She called my brother and I into the room next to the radio room and said folks that have a heavy suitcase to carry, would we help them carry it? And I said yes. I never conceived the entire time I was in People's Temple that Jim Jones would be mad enough to do anything like this, because he asked me several months ago when I was in Jonestown for a short period of time. He asked me a rhetorical question. He said, you know how we just don't all die tomorrow? And there was no crisis going on or anything like that. Like I said, it was a rhetorical question. And I said, no. And he said, because I do not have the moral right to take these babies' lives, these seniors' lives, these people's lives. We came 7,000 miles to live, not to die. And I believed him. I took him at his word.
Why Guyana?
I think there was a number of reasons. One, he had been in Guyana apparently 17 years ago. He liked the people. It was a third world country, black country, and the congregation was predominantly black. It was a government who was trying to start a social society. He had a socialist cooperative, and I'm not sure of all the elements that were involved, but I think those were...
Going back to the money, Maria Katsouris, I think you said, asked you to come in and get this suitcase, and she said what?
Like I said, when she asked us a question, she just asked us if we would help folks deliver a heavy suitcase. She didn't say where or anything else. And I said, yeah, primarily because I just wanted to, I think, get out of Jonestown at that time. Like, if I had been thinking my wife and my son are going to die in the next 5 minutes, I'd have been thinking something entirely different. I'd been thinking how to get them out. And,
You wanted out of Jonestown, why?
Just the whole atmosphere of that day was, I can't describe it. It was like the place was disintegrating, literally disintegrating. It was a very eerie, scary sort of feeling all day long. It was just very, the people leaving and families being broken up, because some of the families, part of the families stay back, some of them go, there's a lot of crying, there's a lot of heavy emotion. One man was ready to leave and take his three kids, not even tell his wife didn't even know that he was leaving, and a very...
So you mean you wanted to get out to go up to Georgetown or something, for a week?
Just whatever. I mean, she said, do you want to go? And I said, yeah, I want to go. But like I said,
You didn't mean get away forever. You just meant
leave
for the time being because it was a bad scene that day.
No, if I wanted to get away from ever, I did.
So there was this suitcase, and then what happened?
Well, you got to take things in sequence. She asked me to get my suit. She asked me if I had a suitcase. I said, yeah. She said, we better change your clothes because I had... not some heavy shoes on, just a t-shirt. Went back to the cottage area, and I changed my clothes and got my suitcase, and we went to West House. And I gave the suitcase to a woman named Carolyn Layton. I didn't go into the house. And her sister, Annie Moore, who was one of Jones's nurses, was coming up on the porch there in front of the house and asked me to go find Maria and ask whether or not two of the children that were there should come to the pavilion or whether they should stay down there. So on the way, I met Maria actually about halfway towards the pavilion, and I heard the word suicide. I didn't hear the context, but I became, at that point, I got a feeling of, I don't know, I can't describe the emotions, terror, dread, like, oh my God, this couldn't be happening, or what I'm afraid might be happening, it can't be happening. And I went back, started back down towards West House, and I met Annie and told her that Maria had said, keep the children down there for now. And I knew we'd need some water, but I think, I don't know, I think I was being drawn towards Pavilion because I wanted to see what was happening. When I got in the kitchen area, I heard a lot of screaming and crying and a lot of going on. So at that point, that's when I thought about my wife and my son. I wanted to see, you know, what was happening.
So you went out, you saw your child dead, you saw your wife dying, you spoke to her, and then
she didn't answer me.
How were you able to flee at that point with this suitcase?
Well, like I said, we've been asked to do something, so apparently, like I said, we had a way out. So I did not see any armed guards, but apparently there were armed guards. I guess, you know, they had been told to let us go. Because it was just entirely something by chance.
So you left with this suitcase, and with who else?
My brother and Mike Probst.
And you didn't know what was in the suitcase?
Well, when I got back, see, while I was witnessing this nightmare, because I just didn't see my wife and my son. I mean, I saw other mothers kneeling, holding their babies and crying, and I saw some bodies on the ground, and it was just a nightmare. I can't describe it. It was a nightmare. When I got back, the suitcase had been filled with money, and I don't know if I guess she told Maria had told Probst to take it to the embassy. He said he doesn't remember if she said Soviet embassy or not. Just take it to the embassy.
Why would Jones have wanted to take this money to the Soviet embassy?
That's a good question. I honestly do not know.
Had the Soviet embassy supplied the money?
I don't know.
You haven't changed cassettes?
Bert, I know you guys have things to do, so we'll finish on this last cassette, okay?
Probst and him were given guns. We were told to kill ourselves if we got caught.
And just to make sure we didn't do anything, just in case we happen to run into somebody and they start going out, you know, it heard that we saw that we dropped the suitcase or something.
How did you two guys link up anyway?
Through Maria.
She got...
When I came back down to West House, he was there. And Probst was already there.
I see.
And so then what was this about guns?
We had them. Maria had given me and Probst guns to kill ourselves if we were caught. And, you know, at that point I thought, woman, you're crazy. I'm going to kill myself, you know.
And you gave it to me.
So,
we're rolling, Justin. Go ahead.
So I went, I think almost the first place we stopped, you know, to bury the money. I had taken, it had 5 rounds.
Why did you stop to bury money?
The suitcase
was
heavy.
Getting too heavy.
At that point, we were running for our lives. We were trying to get out of there.
You see, it had just rained.
I told them after we got back down and we'd left, I said, people starting to die back there. And apparently Maria told Probst they'd gone after the truck to get Ryan. And so, I mean, we knew that somebody was on the loose. You know, I mean, somebody, people's temple members were on the loose. And also it was a matter of survival at that point.
So you did what?
I said it was a matter of survival at that point.
So you did what?
So we ran. With the suitcase, it was heavy, it was awkward. We tried to unload some of the money to make it lighter. It's not easy running through the mud with the suitcase and everything else at the same time when you're trying to run for your life. And when we got to the piggery, we dumped the rest of the money and then went to Port Kaituma. And we kept some money on us, and they had kept the guns for two reasons. One, the guns, in case we ran into any people's temple members who were trying to shoot people up to defend ourselves, and the money in case we ran into any Guyanese or somebody along the way who would try to impair our progress to try to buy them off, just so we could get to safety.
Somebody thought that people's temple members might try to shoot you?
Well, you know, we had heard that, you know, these guys had gone after Ryan, so we didn't know what to think, you know.
What did you hear about that?
You'd have to ask Probst, I don't know.
Just what Mike had told us that, you know, they had gone after Ryan, you know.
Do you have any way of knowing whether or not Jones directed them to do that?
I have no idea, but I would...
I don't know. I can't believe they did it on their own, but I don't know. I mean, that's a good question.
How many people was it who went after Ryan?
I don't know. I mean, I read in newspaper accounts there was 6 or 7, but I don't know.
Do you know who the people were who went after Ryan?
Just what I read in the newspapers, and that's all.
When you first came here to this hotel, many of the survivors from Jonestown were afraid of you.
Right, we were afraid of them.
They said you were a part of Jones' inner group.
Not true.
You'd been given guns by Jones' inner group.
Yeah, right, to kill ourselves if we were caught. Those are the instructions. I mean, it was, that's all been resolved. We understood their paranoia, and I don't think they understood. They didn't know the circumstances surrounding our leaving. And I mean, it was understandable reaction, I think, on their part. And I think they finally realized that we were as afraid of them as they were of us.
Why were you afraid of them?
Well, for any number of reasons. Because we had been considered in leadership. We represented Jim Jones to them. Mainly because there was 20 of them, you know. One of them came up and said, I can't guarantee that one of these people won't try to strangle you in the middle of the night. I mean, there's only 3 of us, there's 20 of them, right? So, I mean, that's another reason. And we didn't want any trouble at all. Like I said, we wanted just to survive. And they were saying a lot of outrageous things at the time, but I mean, that's been worked out. I think it was just a trauma. I mean, everybody went through a trauma, and it was a sudden, I think we were thrown together totally. We asked first not to come to this hotel because they were here and we knew that they were paranoid of us and we didn't want to upset them. Well, they brought us here anyway. Then we asked when we got to the desk, do not take us on the same floor where they are, please, because we don't want to upset them. So not only did they take us to the same floor, they took us right into their bedroom, which immediately caused, you know, a panic reaction on their part. And it was just a matter of talking things out. But that conflict has been resolved. I mean, there's no tension, and we're all talking with each other. You know.
Do you intend to harm anyone?
I do not intend to harm anyone. I mean, I was in Vietnam. I did not believe in violence.
Do you have any knowledge of a plan for People's Temple survivors to harm other people?
No, I think that's just a lot of bunk. I mean, I think Jones used to talk a lot of that, I think, to keep fear in people's hearts, you know. But I can say I'm as afraid for my life right now, I think, as anybody is.
It's a way of keeping people in the temple. You know, the fear that if you left, you would have this great hit squad going after you or whatever, you know. But I think paranoia. I mean, it showed here when we saw each other that, you know, afternoon. We were both paranoid of each other, thinking, you know, they thought we were going after them, and we thought, you know, since we represented that they would go after us. And I'm so afraid, you know, in the States, you know, maybe there really is. I agree with Tim. I think there's this a thing he had, you know, because he didn't trust people at all.
He didn't trust anybody. He said that. Nope, he didn't trust anybody.
What kind of an organization did you think you were a part of, living here in Guyana, working for a man who said, if you ever want out, I've got a hit squad that'll kill you?
Well, one thing I didn't believe a lot of what Jim Jones said.
But what did you think about the fact that here is this man who's invited you to come to Guyana and live and build a better world, and he says, and if you decide you don't like it here anymore, I'll see to it that you're assassinated when you leave. Now, what did you think about that?
Like I said, I thought it was a lot of bunk. I thought it was an intimidation.
But why would this man be intimidating you, and why would you continue to participate in a community, the leader of whom is trying to intimidate you?
See, that's a very complex question. I mean, it's a good question. It's a rational question. But like I said, there's a lot of things that enter into it. You talk about mind control. You talk about, I was here because my wife and son were here. And I was not just going to abandon my son.
why couldn't you just all get up and leave and say, hey, this guy is talking about assassinating us if we want to leave? I don't...
Well, he kept families apart. Like I said, I wasn't going to leave without my wife and my son. When I was in Georgetown, my wife and son were never here. So it was he divided and conquered. He deliberately kept families apart from each other just so that kind of thing wouldn't happen.
There were strange forms of brutality used against children who had misbehaved. We understand they were tied up, left in the jungle, that they were dropped down into wells until they screamed that they would be good and not do whatever it was that they had done that Jim Jones didn't like. And parents stood by and let this kind of thing be done to their children.
That's true. Like I said, your questions are rational, but you're talking about an irrational situation, and the word mind control is not just...
Well, what was going on in your mind as you
I didn't believe it. You know, what I actually thought was, I knew in San Francisco that what they would do sometimes is take a child off into a room and say, all right, when you go out, scream and yell and everything else for effect, you know. And I honestly, that's what I thought was being done. I thought that they were taking these children away and they were coming back screaming and yelling, but they had told them to do that for effect on, you know, for the other children.
Well, didn't
I didn't
this
honestly
all
believe
sound...
that kind of brutality. And
didn't this all sound kind of freaky to you?
Sound freaky?
Yeah, I mean, here you are.
Well, I told you what was
putting yourself and your family into an organization in which people are encouraged to deceive other members of the group for whatever effect that he was taking them off and pretending
she
to torture them and bringing them back so they would scream and make other people think they had been tortured if they hadn't.
You got to remember, you're not thinking rationally. Your mind has been controlled. You've been say it's a very complex question.
You may believe that that's the right thing to do. You may, you know, so
you have to talk to there's a psychiatrist here who's a specialist in cults. And he can answer your question
well,
better.
Well, wait,
than
what was
here.
I going
to
say?
I'm just saying you're made to believe that that's the right way to do. You know, you're made to believe that that's the right type of, discipline for the children. I mean,
made to
there were
it
some
now.
Kids who were, I mean, obviously problem children, you know, from, you know, their backgrounds, whatever they were. And just wouldn't obey the rules of, you know, staying to...
All these, you say, isn't that sort of freaky behavior, but child beating is one of the biggest crimes in the United States right now. You know, and what goes on in prisons in the United States.
Yeah, but you didn't beat your child.
No, I didn't beat my child. I never spanked my child.
But you were willing to let Jim Jones beat your child.
Well, I don't know. That situation never arose. My son was only 15 months old.
But you were willing to let Jim Jones beat other children.
One thing is that... Since May, all physical violence had stopped. There was no more beatings, there was no more that sort of thing. Well, he can tell you he was there.
Why did you continue to participate in a community in which child beating and psychological torture, if you will, were
Can
all...
you please, I mean, one thing you need to understand, all this time, that was her whole life. I've seen exaggerations in this week's Newsweek on some of the things that did happen. I mean, some things did happen, but
happen that you saw? What did you see happen?
The last beating I had seen, or, you know what you say, is a guy who had molested children of 12 years and under, and he was, I mean, and that,
and
one
that,
of those children...
That particular person had a history of molesting children, and he had been given, he had been given psychiatric counseling, he had been... I wasn't there when it happened, but I mean, that was the last resort.
You know, from what we've read, those of you who were living in Jonestown would assemble in a group and you would see people be punished. Mm-hmm. Supposedly one woman who had sex with somebody she wasn't supposed to was forced to have sex with
Can
somebody else.
Can I say
else.
That is a lie? Because, I mean, maybe it would happen when I was in Georgetown, but I never saw that.
What did you see? What kinds of things?
Like I said, I'm telling you now about that one guy who was molesting children and he had a history of doing it. And then what happened is that child had molested even a younger child. One of the 12 or 11-year-olds had molested a younger child. As a matter of fact, one of my cousins. And, you know, a couple of guys had got really upset and went up and hit him. You know, and then a couple more people hit him. And he was just giving all these excuses why, you know, he had no way to control himself and things like that. And it wasn't like every single person who were brought up, you know, for whatever things they had done wrong were beat. You know, I think some people.
Did you see people who were small forced to box people who were big? We've heard about that.
In San Francisco. And that happened in San Francisco, yeah.
What did you think about that?
I thought it was a way of disciplining, but, yeah. But parents sign legal consent forms before any of that happened. Even some people who were out of the organization now, have been out for a long time, sign consent forms. Like, it's you're talking about something, you're asking rational questions, and you're talking about an irrational situation.
What was in your mind at the time is what I want to know.
I thought it was a form of structure that was necessary.
Beating.
You say beating. Have you ever spanked your child? You don't have a child. Well, I got spanked when I was a son. I would like to ask any parent.
We're not
talking
about spanking. We're talking about
spanking. You're talking about spanking. But when it comes out in the media, and say, I don't want to be put in the role of trying to defend this because I don't agree with it. But still, you know, you're asking a question that's trying to put us on the spot. But when you're talking about the spanking, children spank their parents. Child beating is one of the worst crimes that's going on in the United States. I'm not just in the United States, but I mean all over the world, but it manifests itself a lot in the United States.
You saw, in San Francisco, you saw people who had violated some rule or other of Jim Jones,
mm-hmm.
put into a boxing ring, and forced to box somebody that they had no chance against.
Well,
they were in effect beaten up by this other guy.
Mm-hmm.
And you saw that.
Mm-hmm.
And you thought,
I saw that, and so did several thousand other people.
And you thought that was okay.
I thought it was maybe it might change the person because the person was so hard-headed to, you know, just, I mean, usually, I mean, I don't know. It went different times, different things would happen. But, it was a way to, at that time, the way I thought was just a way to maybe structure the person because nothing else went through their head, so maybe that would go through their head.
And what had this person done that this was an appropriate punishment?
Violence. Some
sort. One person had stolen something once from a store.
So in the People's Temple, whatever punishment Jim Jones decided was appropriate to the crime, you thought was okay?
We didn't argue with the leader.
So if Jim Jones wanted to beat somebody up...
I mean, if you had an argument with the leader, then you took your argument to him, but you never argued publicly. I had a lot of complaints and hostilities and arguments that I took to him.
You watched Jim Jones supervising the beating of children, the beating of people, the dropping of children into wells and forced to scream.
I never saw any children.
Never saw that either.
You didn't see that?
No.
Like I told you. I told you what I thought was happening.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. I'm sorry. You did. But you thought all of these were appropriate if Jones felt that this was the way to achieve whatever he wanted, and if it would work, that was the only thing that mattered to you. Would the punishment accomplish the purpose?
Generally, yes.
Can I just ask a question? I mean, one thing that he would, especially in the States, would say a lot, I mean, which would you rather have? You know, us, this organization disciplining your children, or juvenile hall?
So any discipline that Jim Jones decided was good for your child was okay with you?
Well, my child wasn't quite old enough to be disciplined. I mean, at being a baby. But,
we understand some babies were spanked.
I've never seen it. I mean, I don't know what you consider baby. I've never seen it.
You know, you say something like this. I don't want to be in a position of defending Jim Jones or that, but... I mean, you ask a misleading question. They understand some babies were spanked. I don't know any parent in America has a spanked their child. I mean, if your fire, well, if
you
your child,
spank
if your child,
child is a few months old.
No. I never saw any child a few months old spanked. Never.
So the only discipline you saw and that you've had firsthand knowledge of was the beating in San Francisco of someone who had stolen something.
Yeah, and public confrontation. I mean. The thing that was used most was humiliation, not beatings. It was public humiliation.
Like what?
Well, you could get brought up in front of the entire congregation for whatever it is that you might have done. Why did you do this? It was a peer pressure sort of thing. It's the thing that's used in most... I know it's used in China. I've never been to China, but from what I've read, it's used in China, where a person is humiliated in front of the community, and because of that, it's a peer pressure. sort of thing. It's called group catharsis, group therapy.
I understand that women used to stand up and talk about having had sex with Jim Jones and how great it was.
Mm-hmm.
You saw that?
Mm-hmm.
You were in the audience?
Yeah.
And women stood up?
Well, most of it was done at least in the States. I never saw it here in Guyana. But I wasn't in Jonestown that much. In the States, most of it was done in a group called the Planning Commission, which was a group of about 120 people who made most of the business decisions for the organization. See, Jones emasculated. He had to maintain the image of the leader. The leader had to be the great lover, the best lover, you know. And for the most part, those people were told what to say. You know, I mean, I don't have any first-hand knowledge of what he was like because I never went to bed with the man. But it was all part of a show. It was all part of a stage.
Well, what did you think when you were a part of a group and you're all around and women are standing up and saying, I had sex with Jim Jones and it was the best sex I ever had, and did you think that this was the way to run an organization?
Well, I understood from the point that leader has to see, there's always competition between males, you know, and that's one way of emasculating the males.
If it made Jim Jones look bigger, it was okay with you?
Yeah, I thought that the image of the leader should be maintained. Whether or not I believed it, you know, is irrelevant.
Whether or not you believe the sex had really taken place.
Or whether or not it was all that, you know, good.
You thought it was a good thing that this sort of thing was being perpetrated.
Can I just say one thing before we go any further? I mean, you must understand that's what we did believe. We're telling you what we were thinking next, okay? So I don't want it used against us because, you know, obviously we were fools to stay in that organization. I'm realizing more. I was a fool. And I hope none of this is going to be held against us. I mean, I'm sure we'll follow us the rest of our lives.
It will be. Don't worry.
You know, but I mean, Christ, we're going to have to start a change somewhere. And unfortunately, it had to start now. But that's, you know, that's just unfortunately the way it goes.
What would you like to add? Anything that I've asked you that you think is important?
There's so much to the story of People's Temple. I mean, it's as much of a dream as a nightmare, in some sense. You know.
I think what happened was monstrous. It was a horror. I don't think there's any words in the English language to describe the crime that took place in Jonestown, and I'll have guilt for the rest of my life that I didn't do something to stop it, when maybe I could have.
And yet, as you try now to understand the way you were thinking and the way you were feeling at that time,
mm-hmm.
you didn't try to stop it because...
See, this is a very complex thing. Again, he did know that there was these rehearsals. I never went through one. And the last time somebody left, when Debbie Layton left, I wasn't there, but I guess they had a white knight. I had a wife and a son who I was concerned about, and no way to get them out. And then you always had the specter of if you left, what happened, if what did happen, what if that happened? Then you'd be responsible for all those people. It was a way of controlling a person. So you had a lot of continual conflict going on. I mean, I would think, well, if I leave, first I wouldn't have left without my son, my wife. I mean, to begin with, if I'd ever had the chance, I would have. But then after that, then you think, well, what happens if you're the one that triggers this insanity that did happen?
Did you expect this thing to happen?
No, I didn't. Like I said, if I did, I got my wife and son out of there long ago.
Never thought.
See, you have to understand the condition that your mind is in. It's a fear. It's a fear mechanism that's used to keep people in place.
Do you have any relatives in there?
I don't think it's any of your business.
Do they tell you anything about the people in Guyana at all?
You know, seem to know more than anyone else. Excuse me, please.
Are you a member of People's Temple?
No, I am not a member of People's Temple.
Can we get your name, please?
Excuse me.
Still on copy?
Get an
all copy.
Oh yes, thank you.
Yes, you want your own copy? Yes.
Ready? Now, sir, tell me when you last saw your family and under what circumstance they went to Guyana.
I saw them about 3 months ago. They left without my knowing. Yeah. And my wife went to the bank, drew the money out. No one let me know. Taking my kids to Guyana, then no one said nothing. And it was about 2 months before I heard from my kids, and my kids wrote me a letter. They were all saying the same thing. You know, we like the weather here, the flowers, the garden. We're got free Medicare, free everything over there. This San Francisco, the United States, is the best country in the world right here, you know, to live in. They get free Medicare, they get free schooling, free everything, get paid to do anything they want to do here, you know. But then she take them off and go over there following Jim Jones.
Let me ask you then, were you afraid that something terrible would happen to them?
Yes, I was. People had told me that the man had made up some kind of medicine or something to kill them all, you know. And if something occurred like the incident just happened, which I don't know, you know, I'm not a part of it, you know. I used to be in it about 4 or 5 years ago, but I got out of it after I seen what the man was doing, brainwashing the people.
Now, after you heard the events of this weekend, what was in your mind?
In my mind, hoping that my kids was okay, then that I would see them again, and my wife. Yeah. I really would like to see them again and get some kind of protection, you know.
What do you think may have happened?
Hopefully, I don't know. I'm wishing for the best, that they're okay. If anything did happen to them, maybe it's, make the United States look up and see what's going on, you know.
Government would help you.
Government would help, yeah, right.
What kind of church is it that would do this thing to your family?
This is not a church. I don't think this is a church. A church don't search you as you go in. Church don't keep guns and people are giving you a bad time, you know. This man is taking people's money. My sister, she got over $30,000 from her husband's death. She had a home, he taken it all. She just gave it to her, you know, here it is. And I don't know, it's not a church. A church doesn't do these things, you know, like this man do.
Did you know that your family might have taken an oath to commit suicide if this man wished?
No, I don't. I don't know about that. If they did, I don't know.
What is your feeling? Tell me about the children and so on.
My children are very smart in school. I have 5 A students in school that was here. 2 of them was 8 and 9. They was good in school. You know, this is beginning. My baby wrote a letter, you know, come from over there. I got a letter from her the other day. Someone had wrote it for her and she copied it down, you know, made a copy of it, telling me how great it was over there and all this, a 9-year-old baby. You know, babies don't say these things, you know. They're saying something that I don't want to hear about the flowers, the monkeys, and the bananas, you know. I don't want to hear that.
Yeah. What was it that made your wife do this?
I don't know, the following of Jim Jones, the People's Temple there. That's all I can say. And the talk, which when we first went there, we thought it was a good thing that something would come out of it to help the kids. Help kids, young kids, get out of the streets and off the corners and things, try to help them. People was taking food and money, church, you know, $2 or $3. Then he started asking for hundreds, thousands, and everything, you know.
What do you think can be done to save your family now?
Government, go down in there and bring them out. They went to Japan, Germany, brought them out. Why they can't go over there? Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
And they also stopped Hitler. So why can't they stop this man? He's not a god.
What did you just say?
He's not a God. As he say, tell people that he's God. Throw away your Bible. You don't need the Bible. Throw away. Take my word.
Okay, thank you. The fact is that you did ask before for people to help you out.
Yes, I asked people to help me, and the only help that I got really was from the Channel 4, as you know. They talked to me about it. I went to their Chronicle. They said no. They wouldn't even talk. Went to the editor there. Mm-hmm. And I also called Channel 7, called KGO. No, it's nothing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But now, it takes 400 people to commit suicide, and the others.
In neighborhoods like this, the back streets behind the People's Temple here in San Francisco, relatives of hundreds more went to Guyana, wait for news of the investigation. Irv Chapman, ABC News, San Francisco. For more from the government scene.
I feel a little bit comfort in the fact that many politicians in this country were seduced by Jim Jones and thought he was a very wonderful person, too. The difference between them and the people in the church was the fact that they got gradually caught up into something that became more violent as weeks went by, and there was the fear. There was a fear that if you left the group, that you would be killed. Can you stop us? I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought.
How is it that Jones could attract people and hold them through all of this bizarre, really perverted thing?
Well, like it's been mentioned before by others in the group, Jim Jones started out as presenting a picture of a very loving congregation, very concerned about children's programs, senior citizens' homes, activities for the children, influencing legislation for civil rights, trying to get politicians in government that would be, helpful in changing the society so it wouldn't be so bad. We all recognize that there were definite problems in our particular system, where there are so many people that do without, and some have very much the advantage here. I myself had marched with Martin Luther King in Selma, Alabama. I had been involved in civil rights movements all my life, so this was probably my rallying point around a leader who seemed to be able to have a lot of strength, a lot of followers, and a lot of plot. But it was so difficult to get out of the group once you got in, because gradually you realized you'd been sucked into a situation where if you left, that you were a traitor, and he had vowed to have all traitors killed.
No, you don't. You look cheerful. You
want
a cup of coffee or something?
Not right now. I've had 4 hours sleep in the last 2 nights.
I'm getting some sleep. Yeah. Okay. Al, how is it that, what is it about the People's Temple, what is it about the Reverend Jones, that he was able to attract so many people and hold them through all these bizarre and perverted happenings that you saw and everybody else talks about?
Well, aside from the fact that people came into People's Temple for various reasons, healings, political views, or just the general loving atmosphere of the church, what kept them into the group once they found something that they liked was the fear of retaliation if they left. Jones was always telling the congregation, and particularly the Planning Commission, that if there are any defectors, if anything happens to me or People's Temple, that the first thing to do is go after the traitors, then kidnap politicians if I'm in jail for and hold them for ransom. As things got bad gradually, first they started whippings with a belt, a few whacks, and for minor infractions such as drinking and smoking or being late for work. But they gradually got to where they wanted to switch. Then they had people undress and go into the pool, jump into the pool in their underclothes. One man happened not to have any underclothes, so he made him strip down anyway and had to walk naked back to the pool and jump in. Then they went to the board, which was about 2.5 inches wide, about 4 feet long, about 3 feet long, and about 3/4 inch thick. And they started off with maybe 25, and then the beatings got up to, the most I can remember is 150. My daughter received 75 whacks with his board, and when she went to school and dressed down for gym, the girl said her butt looked like hamburger. The first whack brought out excruciating screams from everyone. Then the fact that the church had many functions, there were people...
Did you ever witness any of these beatings?
I witnessed hundreds of beatings. I might even go as far as to say 1,000.
Didn't you want to stop it? Didn't you want to do something?
Yes. At the end, that's what caused me to leave, was because he was becoming so sadistic in his beatings, to the point where you could even hear him laughing, giggling under his voice over the loudspeaker when people were being beaten, or while senior citizens were up there boxing one another. They had some senior citizens box a retarded girl for having made a racist statement, and she would fall down and they'd pick her up and she was bleeding, and then the counselors would hold her up while they could, so they could still beat on her. It was so sadistic that, and we knew the dangers of leaving, so we talked about it for some time before we actually made the decision to leave. And in making a decision to leave People's Temple, you have to decide you'd rather die than go back.
Why is that?
Because they threatened to kill all traitors. When we left, we had all kinds of threatening phone calls, threatening letters, all of which had been turned over to the authorities. They broke into my house using my daughter, who was still in the church a year after we were in, because the people who lived upstairs from where we lived knew she was my daughter. She just said she forgot the key and was gonna have to break in a window, and they unloaded loads of stuff, some very incriminating stuff against People's Temple that I had. I accidentally came across, but I also had all the pictures of People's Temple. I was their photographer. I had all the picture files, all the membership files, and we had planned to give those back to them, but we wanted some kind of an agreement with them before we did give it back for our safety. We did manage to maintain quite a bit of stuff so that we do have a lot of security.
Did you ever at any time try to get the authorities, any authorities, to investigate the People's Church? Did you warn them about these things? If so, what did you do?
Well, at first we were afraid to go to any authorities because Jones had the politics tied up so much in Redwood Valley, Ukiah. He elected the sheriff, the police chief, and the same thing happened in San Francisco. He's very responsible in the election of the political officials there, Mayor Moscone and the likes. But my wife and I thought for a long time, who could we possibly get to help us, you know? We wrote a letter to Ralph Nader, not trusting him, but thinking maybe he could help us. We signed the letter, gave him so much information, and said, if you want to hear more, put an ad in the Chronicle to Angela, and how for Angela to contact him. Well, he sent the letter back to the district attorney's office, and Tim Stone was in the district attorney's office. The district attorney said, well, here's something about People's Temple. You want to take care of this? And Tim Stone naturally took a devoted follower of Jones at the time, took the letter back to Jim Jones. So nothing ever came of it. There was no investigation at all. I gave all the threatening letters to the Treasury Department. They fingerprinted it. I later was interviewed by the San Francisco District Attorney's Office, and they seemed willing to take all the information from many of us, but I pointed out that there were fingerprints on one of those letters that we had received. And to this day, I have not been asked who I thought those fingerprints might be of, who the possibilities were.
When did you do all this? When did you go to the Treasury? When did you go to the San Francisco Police? When did they interview you?
Oh, probably about 2 years ago, we told the Treasury Department that they were shipping arms to Guyana. They said that they would keep an eye on it, but obviously either they're not telling or they didn't find anything. We knew that they were taking large sums of money down. There was no way they could check even an airplane list until after it had taken off to know who was on the plane. So I know, I understand that, you know, the government having their own limitations because of the legal ramifications. But it was extremely difficult. It was only until New West started a story that we felt maybe someone had the courage to stand up against People's Temple, Jim Jones. We called these reporters, not giving them our real names at first, and telling them some of the things that happened, and they begged us to come out. They said, as long as you remain unidentified, people are still going to be beaten in the chairs, children are going to be beaten. Only until somebody stands up will it ever get out. So we decided that, you know, we would rather die than see this go on, so we did come out publicly at that time.
What did you, how did the seeding of all your property take place? What did you do and why?
My wife and I had 19, we quit for a few months back in 1960, I believe, about 6 to 8 months after we joined the church, because it began to get a little bit extremely restrictive, you know. They wanted to know every move you made, and so we, I had just gotten my retirement check from Standard Oil, so I put it into this property in Willits, plus a note, a deed I'd had on another property. And we figured that we could retire after it was paid off, because I was getting up in years. I had already worked 19 years in Standard Oil, and it was becoming more difficult to get a job at my age. So the children begged us to come back into the church, and he kept pleading with the children. He'd call us on the phone saying, I haven't told anybody you've left the church. I told them you were on a mission. He had all kinds of ways of getting to you, you know. And so we finally decided, well, we weren't doing anything to help the world change by being out of the church. And at least the people in there were making an effort to make this a better world to live in. So we did go back. They then told us that they were going to send us as missionaries to Africa, and that we would need to sign over our property to the church so that they would be able to handle it, give them a power of attorney. So we thought that made sense, and they said, we may all be coming over there with you, and we will have to dispose of the property. Well, we prepared for this trip and came down to the library, studied Africa. Then they decided that Africa was a bad place to go about 1 or 2 days before we were ready to take off on the plane. You're going to Peru. So we came down and studied to go to Peru. And it wasn't until some time later that we realized that this whole thing was just a means of getting us to turn over our property to the church.
And you turned it all over?
And we did turn it all over.
19 houses?
Yeah, 19 houses and 2 houses in Redwood Valley.
Just one last question. Did you ever see anyone close to you get administered one of these beatings or some of these cruel tortures that you've been talking about? And if so, were you inclined to do anything? Did you want to do anything?
Yeah, when they really got brutal, I felt like just going up and just tearing the whole place apart. But I knew that if I made one move, the guards would beat me up, you know? That I wouldn't have accomplished anything. I would have been watched constantly after that. The only way of getting out is to never tell anybody you're going out. You know, and if you're thinking it, you don't tell anybody. Fortunately, my wife and I made a pact that we would always talk to one another. And no one was allowed, husband or wife, to talk against the church at all. Jim Jones, anything. If they did, they were supposed to turn them in. And they did. It was just like Hitler, you know, turn children against their parents and spouse against spouse. I'm not sure I answered the question, but if you'd like to ask any more, I'd be happy to help you.
No, I think you answered it.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Okay, Jeff.
What are you concerned about?
Well, I'm for, I was told, like, we signed and almost had them, and I said, we signed papers, to do, I hate my children, I molested my children when they were babies, I would like to see them dead, and then he would have them say, if you ever do anything to hurt me or this organization, I will give these to the authority, you will be arrested in the city.
He's very supportive.
Obviously, he wasn't going to harm himself. You know, he wants to go down in history as Lenin reincarnated. He's not going to take his own life. So he has to be very sick there, stunned. I'm thinking that any moment I was going to plastic bubble.
I've been members of the People's Temple for so long, knowing all this was going on.
Fear, the fear tactics, and also the brainwashing that was done by a superior teacher, Jim Jones.
How was it conducted, the brainwashing?
Constantly. We've had meetings sometimes 5 days a week, and we were always told that when the no-knock came out, they were saying, remember the Jews in Hitler, the concentration camp, that's why Hunter's Point is, so they can get all these black people in the area and bomb them. We were told that fascism, you know, was going to take over, and that we were also told that we'd have to.
She fell on the floor. It was a loud blast. I said, hey, wait a minute.
We were told also that the KKK was going to destroy us. When the temple originated in Indianapolis, Indiana. The Ku Klux Klan would pick it out in front of our church, so we knew that a lot of these things he was saying was very much reality, that there were a lot of racists, and so we knew that it could easily happen here. So we all gave our money, our property, everything we own, so we could go to get out of the country. At first he said Canada. It was his promised land that he was going to free his people. So willingly we just got into it so we wouldn't be in concentration camps and murdered like the Jews. The brainwashing, oh my goodness, it's like Jim Jones, we were called him Father, we called him God. Any pictures that we had of movie stars or whatever we took down, we put nothing but his pictures up around us. We were told never to question him. We were witness people dropping dead, supposedly dropping dead, with a friend of mine that is in hiding now was poisoned, that we witnessed someone slip something in her drink because they said she stole some money. We had guards constantly around the church. We were constantly watched when we go to school, whatever. Hey, we were afraid to talk to our own parents, because when we did, we were turned in for being negative.
You were in the church for 8 years.
Yes.
When did he start talking about people killing themselves?
Around 72, 1972.
How did he break that news?
He would say that, now, if the people, the government officials or whatever, were to come in here and try to destroy us or take us or try to expose me or us, then we would kill ourselves. He also said that traitors, meaning myself, those the defectors, were over to leave, there would be 200 people left over to come and kill them. People would stand up and raise their hand, Father, I'll take care of them personally for you. These people at the time had guns on them that constantly would carry guns. We were just, he just, and then he said that we would kill ourselves while trying to defend ourselves so no one would live to tell the story of the things that happened, that we would all kill ourselves. And the parents were told and signed a statement and just badgered that they would kill the kids. So I know for a fact these kids or these babies, my brothers and sisters there in that town did not kill themselves. I feel that strongly because I was a part of that. I heard that constantly from him. It's an example for Mrs. Amos, who killed her three kids, slit their throats, and then herself.
At this point, I am past
you are concerned at this point about your relatives there.
Very much so.
When you come here and you look at the marker and you remember, even though it's been almost 3 years, what sort of thoughts go through your mind?
Just the thought of why my family went over there and why the other people went over to Guyana to be with Jim Jones. And this was the best country here in the world, right here in the United States. And many things go through my mind. Why? When? What could we do? You know, what could the people do about this? This, all this killing going that has happened. And I just feel, you know, I just sit and cry, go back to the car and go home, go to bed, stay here about 2 or 3 hours or so and leave.
You have a lot of questions. Do you have any answers?
I don't have no answers. No one has had any answers yet, has given me any answers to nothing.
Tell me about that last day in 1978 that you saw your family.
The morning I got up to go to work, they all kissed me, bye, Daddy, bye, Daddy. My little boy gave me some old coins that I had given him and some script. And he said, keep these for me, Dad. I said, what's wrong? He said, I thought maybe some of the kids was trying to take the money from him. You know, he gave me, and I told him, okay, I'll keep them. So I went to work and I came home that afternoon, I mean, that night from work. When I got home, the whole house was clean. Nothing was in the house, nothing but a TV and a twin bed. And about around 10:30, 11 o'clock that night, two women came in from this People's Temple telling me that my family was gone to Guyana. And that really hurt me then. It hurt me better then to find out they was gone on their way to Guyana than it did when I found out that they were all dead.
Must have some bitterness, or at least have had some bitterness toward the People's Temple for doing that to your family.
I have bitterness then, and I have bitterness now towards it. and I didn't like the way that they did it, and I don't like it now.
Your family left you. Eventually they died. How do you handle that psychologically?
Well, I put all the newspapers, the TV, TV I doesn't watch any of it, you know, about the what happened over there. I got some of the tapes at home. I put them in a drawer in the safe deposit box, and I don't read anything about it. I just go to work and back home.
You try to just shut it out of your mind?
I can't shut it out of my mind, but I do the best I can with it, you know. This one guy there, Frank Petrini's brother, he had a son in a coma for about 7 or 8 months. He came out of the coma, and he told his mother that he wanted to see me. He wanted to come to the market and see me when he came out of the coma. He walked through the door and he hugged me. Fred, how are you doing? I think the man has, you know, he was dead, came back alive and wanted to see me, wanted to know how I was feeling. And that really helped me there too, throughout, you know, with it.
Have you had any counseling?
Just people talking, you know.
No professional counseling?
No professional, no.
Do you feel in the need of it, for it?
Well, no, not really. I think that I'm doing okay, you know, without it.
You yourself, you were never involved in the People's Temple. What did your family tell you about why they were involved?
They thought it was something good, and I thought it was something good myself one time. You know, they was taking the kids out, horseback riding, swimming, skating, something that I didn't have a chance to do, you know, because I was working every day. Take them on vacations, and you know, people would do different things for them. They, you know, which they was taking the money, they was giving the money, and taking them on vacations where I didn't have a vacation but once a year, and I didn't have a chance to take them to the every, you know, every week or every 2 weeks on, you know, go someplace. But I thought it was nice at one time. Then it got where it was, just got out of hand.
Who do you blame for it all?
I don't know who to put the blame on, really, you know. I guess I put it on a lot of the black churches in the neighborhood there, because they could have gotten Jim Jones out of San Francisco when he got there, you know. And, you know, they saw what he was doing, and we got no help. No one got any help with it, you know, to try to get him out of there. You know, they say, well, I can take those people and do so many things with them, and so much violence and everything was going on in the city. And so I think this is, you know, really what happened with this.
But in the Holocaust of November 18th, 1978, who do you blame in that?
Well, it could be a lot of people involved in that, you know. Really, you can't put the blame on the government. I think the government had a lot to do with it.
But why?
Because they could have went over there. They could have went over there with Leo Ryan. They could have had someone to go with him before that and investigated Jim Jones.